Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hello, thank you very much for coming here today this afternoon. We're very happy to have with us Michael Mateus. Michael is actually the MacArthur Chair at the University of California, Santa Cruz, where he was also the founding director of the Center for Games and Playable Media. So Michael is also the co-director of the Expressive Intelligence Studio, and he's actually going to talk to us today about AI and the promise of interactive storytelling. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. So I'll start this talk by looking at the current state of content authoring for games and other forms of interactive entertainment. In the current state of content authoring, content is lovingly handcrafted, right? Sort of carefully trained artists and designers work their magic, work their craft on each of the assets that appears in the game so as to create a specific crafted experience for the player. If we look at sort of typically handcrafted assets you might find in games, those include things like models, textures, levels, animations, sound effects, voice acting, and so forth. But there are some problems with this handcrafted approach. For one thing, has trouble scaling, that as we create ever larger game worlds at ever higher production values, the game industry starts finding itself in a situation where it can't meet the production challenge in a cost-effective way. And this is something at the Game Developers Conference for the last several years, starting with the current generation consoles, there was a lot of sort of hand-wringing and concern about how are we going to sort of recoup investment on games that cost, $50 million plus to produce. But more fundamentally, and for the purposes of this talk, more interestingly, handcrafting really limits interaction and gameplay. Because in addition to handcrafted levels and animations and textures and so forth, oftentimes the interaction itself is handcrafted. So here we see sort of a cartoonish finite state machine representation of a simple adventure game. But many game interactions, quest lines in RPG, NPC dialogue interaction really is composed of this kind of handcrafted sort of explicit script and trigger systems. And this deeply limits interaction and gameplay because, of course, as you try to open the interactive possibilities, this approach to authoring exponentially explodes. So how do we... How can we think about making games that are able to move beyond this kind of handcrafted, pre-scripted interaction, particularly in regards to character and storyline interaction? And the path out can be found by thinking about Pong. One of the first video games, not the first, Space War was the first, but among the first, in thinking about playable models and simulations. Computational models are really a way to escape the bounds of scripting. The bonds of scripting. And you can see that by thinking about what Pong would be like if you redesigned it as a choose-your-own-adventure style interaction. So this, you can actually Google Paper Pong on the web, and there is a sort of choose-your-own-adventure version of Pong where here we start on a screen, the ball is coming towards us, move the paddle up, turn to page 114, move the paddle down, turn to page 117. I turn the paddle down, turn to page 117, oh, the ball is a little closer, right? And now turn up to page 33, down to page 121. Oh, I went down to page 121, and now look, page 25, up or down. And what's page 25? Game over. I missed the ball, right? So, we immediately see if we try to take that same kind of handcrafted, prescripted approach to something like Pong, how kind of ridiculous it is, right? This is not the way you would build a ball and paddle game. Instead, Pong makes use of a very simple physics model, an underlying physics model about sort of reflection and how the ball reflects depending on where you hit it on the paddle and whether the paddle is moving at the time you hit the ball. And from this really simple underlying simulation, you can get a lot of sort of rich and emergent state possibilities in the state space of the game. So really, what we would like to do is to create the same kind of playable models for things like character interaction and storytelling. This is really the way out from scripting, is to say, you know, what Pong did for simple physics in creating an underlying computational model and simulation, we need to do for storytelling and character interaction. A term we like to use for these at Santa Cruz is playable models. So in building a playable model, you're really moving authoring to the meta level. So I'm not sort of saying that we should abdicate human authorship. Human authorship is actually what makes games and interactive experiences powerful and moving and potentially profound. But rather, we want to move that sort of loving handcrafting up to a meta level. So still hand, you know, still lovingly crafted, but not canned. Now you're lovingly crafting a model. The reason we like to use the word playable model instead of just simulation, because it sounds very similar to a simulation, is that these kind of computational models need to be deeply responsive to audience activity, and they have to support the audience in creating useful mental models of the game, or useful mental models of the underlying model. So this is different from, you can imagine like a physics simulation of, say, two black holes colliding. So there's a very well-known astrophysics department at UC Santa Cruz, and they do build simulations of, you know, black holes colliding and other kinds of astrophysical phenomenon. Those are simulations, but they're not playable models. They don't support someone in being able to iteratively experiment with the system, get immediate and continuous feedback in a way that allows you to form an actionable internal model of what's going on in the system. So that's sort of an additional design challenge on top of simulation that you need to do to make the simulation playable. This kind of deep modeling of content, moving beyond kind of canned content, is really more than just a way out of the content crisis, right? People have been talking about procedural content generation for a while, which is related here. Procedural content generation is another form of, you know, deep modeling of content, but it's not just a sort of content crisis issue. It's actually the key to creating new genres of computer-based entertainment. And this really is our fundamental mission in the Expressive Intelligence Studio at UC Santa Cruz. Our goal is to create these new forms of interactive entertainment that provide deeply autonomous, generative, and dynamic responses. And the key to achieving that level of dynamism and autonomy and generativity are modeling currently static aspects of the experience, right? Parts of the experience like, you know, levels or storyline or character interaction that currently are kind of static on top of whatever the simulation and game rule system is. No, we want to actually computationally model that now, but we also need to create new authoring tools that boost authoring power, because you can't just sort of say, okay, we're going to move to deep modeling of content. Okay, go make games with this, right? This actually requires new forms of authoring and new kinds of authoring tools. So you have to think about the whole pipeline if you're going to move to this kind of representation as well. And then, of course, we actually have to build new kinds of interactive experiences, experimental games, because to really cash out this research, if you just sort of imagine what, you know, an interactive experience might need and then work on your AI gizmo to do it, but you never actually do the design work to build a compelling player experience, you don't know if you're even asking the right questions. Research questions on the technology side will arise from trying to build the experience. And in turn, the new technology research that pushes on will make you think of new kinds of experiences you wouldn't have thought of authoring before. So you need that sort of complete loop between the kind of design and artistry side of the research endeavor and the kind of technology and AI side of the research endeavor. I'll point out that ICE, the Expressive Intelligence Studio, is one of four labs that's part of our new Center for Games and Playable Media. And at the end of the talk, I'm going to kind of briefly describe the other labs and kind of give you a picture of the full center. All right, so for most of this talk, the sub-theme within the Expressive Intelligence Studio I'm going to focus on is really computational narrative. Right? This is about AI and the promise of interactive storytelling, which is really how do we make playable models around character and narrative. And there's a lot of hard and interesting research questions that come up if you're trying to move towards this sort of holodeck dream of interactive storytelling. You need to think about how do you build autonomous characters that have intentionality, emotional responses, rich decision-making and reactive capabilities that are also kind of believable and compelling. How do you do story management and generation, where the system dynamically guides a non-static storyline as a function of how the player actually interacts and generates new stories dynamically? How do you sort of handle and model social interaction, since most forms of storytelling that people find engaging or commonly involve characters socially interacting with each other? So we're going to need to tackle social interaction to really take on interactive storytelling. We're going to need dialogue, and this might mean in both dialogue generation and understanding, ultimately. And we're going to need to work on this authoring problem. How do you support authors in creating these kind of generative stories? So within ICE, we're working on a number of these fronts. We're doing work on the authoring side, which I'm not going to talk about today, but this is sort of a screenshot of a comic pain style programming environment we're building to allow non-programmers and non-AI researchers to be able to build generative interactive stories by being able to kind of visually specify preconditions and action and sub-goaling and so forth, but using kind of a visual programming comic pain metaphor. We're also doing work on what we call supporting character realism, and trying to understand the different kinds of realism and believability that you can create with autonomous characters. So, on one end you have sort of Turing test realism, which is about trying to kind of duplicate the human, right, and fool someone into not being able to tell the difference between the human and the computer. On the other end, you have believability, where the person's not fooled. Like, from the get-go, they know this is a computer-controlled character, but they don't care that it's computer-controlled. They're not thinking, like, oh, this isn't realistic. They're thinking, this is really engaging and interesting. In the same way that if I'm watching, like, a Warner Brothers cartoon, I'm not sitting there feeling confused, like, God, Bugs Bunny doesn't seem very realistic. Right? Well, realism's not the issue. I know he's not real, but he's believable and engaging. Then in the middle, we have this area we're trying to hit called supporting character realism, where you're not trying to fool people. You're not sort of presenting someone with a choice. One of these things is real, one's not. Can you tell the difference? But you're trying to create sort of background characters and social situations that might be a mixture of humans and computers, and it just doesn't even come into consciousness to question which is which. Right? And that's a difference from both believability and supporting character, believability and Turing test realism. So this project is part of trying to actually perform experiments with players, where we can sort of quantitatively suss out distinctions along that spectrum. And then in the prom, which I'll be talking about in more detail, in prom week, we're modeling social interaction and trying to come up with these playable models of social interactions and social games. But the first project I want to start with is Facade. This was a project that my friend and collaborator Andrew Stern and I released 5 years ago now. That was our throwing down the gauntlet on the interactive drama problem, right? So there's this kind of holodeck dream of you enter a story world from a first-person perspective. There's autonomous characters. You're interacting with them. And as you interact with them and are able to have full conversations with them, an interesting and dynamic storyline moves forth, right? That's sort of the holodeck dream. And we kind of felt like for years people had been talking about this dream. Brenda Laurel, wrote a book on it. Everyone was sort of trying to skirt around it, right? Kind of find design moves around it. So we wanted to just sort of take it on and see how far we could get. I'm just going to play a bit of a video trailer of, if I can find where I set that up. Yeah, I have got way too many things open down here. there we go. All right, so just to provide a little bit of setup about this experience, and it's available for play, by the way, if you haven't played it before. If you go to interactivestory.net, you can download it. And so our goal was to make this publicly available and to get as many people as possible to play it and sort of talk about it, to kind of put the idea out there. When you first play the experience, you receive this kind of awkward phone message from your friend Trip, who you haven't seen for many years. You guys were friends in college, inviting you over to his and his wife's apartment for drinks. and then you show up at the door at the beginning. Unbeknownst to you, this Grace and Tripp's marriage, the couple, is in serious trouble. And in fact, tonight's the night it's all going to explode. And kind of how they feel about each other and about you depends on how you interact with them during 20 minutes of kind of high-stakes social interaction. So one of our explicit models for this sort of story arc and story development was Albies, Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. So you're basically the visitor, and instead of the visitor being a couple, there's a single individual visitor. You'll see typing on the bottom. We are using an unrestricted natural language interaction. So we're doing natural language understanding. I'll touch briefly on the kind of island parsing we're doing. The characters, when you see them, most of the animation's procedural. The faces are fully procedural and are under continuous real-time control by the AI. So none of this is like triggering like, you know, canned animations or something. It's like continuous AI control. And then the storyline is dynamically evolving and managed by a drama manager. In this video trailer, what we've done is kind of shot over the shoulder of players playing and kind of spliced together little bits of interaction to give kind of an accelerated video a sense of the arc. And you also choose your own name and gender when you first start playing, and this character is Andrew, has chosen Andrew.
Andrew! Ah, I'm so happy you could make it. We haven't seen you in so long. How's it going, man? Oh, we're great. I mean, really, really great. Come on in!
Andrew? Hi, how are you? Oh, it's so nice to see you. It feels like it's been forever.
Yeah, how are you doing?
I just asked him that.
Well, I can ask him too.
Oh, and I've got to say, you look really good.
Well, it's funny how after a full day's work designing magazine ads, Grace finds the time to decorate and redecorate.
I guess it's just the artist in me dying to get out. You know, for this corner of the room, I had a desire for something big and bold.
Yeah, this is a huge couch.
Thank you. I knew you'd give me an honest answer.
It's just decorating, for Christ's sake. You're turning it into some
big issue.
You know,
Tripp, if you hadn't convinced me to go into advertising, I could have painted that painting on the wall instead of buying it.
That's the problem with this goddamn apartment. Lousy acoustics. And then Grace buys all of this ridiculously expensive furniture that just sucks up your voice when you're talking. I feel like someone's muffling me when I sit on her new couch. See, Grace? As always, you're the only one unhappy with your decorating.
Right, I know. I'll never be satisfied with it. I shouldn't get so obsessed about it. It's just not worth it. Ugh. Where's my drink? Oh, hey, you're hugging me.
Oh, that's nice of you.
So there's a few gestures you can do as well.
Brr. I'm gonna have to turn up the thermostat if we're gonna talk about sex.
Tripp, no, that's not funny. Come on. Andrew? You know that flirting with me is only going to make me wish I'd married you instead of Tripp.
Okay, that's enough, you two lovebirds. Okay, Andrew, I think this evening
so
is
So this
over.
Is one of the ways the experience can end, is that you get kicked out
so
before the ending. It's kind of the premature ending.
Oh, no. Andrew, I just realized. I'm sorry.
What?
I haven't gotten us drinks. When it comes to drinking, I have the simplest tastes. I'm always satisfied with the best. So, what's your poison? Can I interest you in a single malt scotch? It's primo. I served them at our last party. They were a smash. Martinis. Perfect. Classic. Great idea.
Well, it didn't take long for you two to bond or whatever. Tripp thinks he's at his classiest when he's on the serving end of a swizzle stick.
Why don't I make us one of my new drink inventions? I call it Grace's Inner Soul. It's a mixture of Chardonnay, bitters, and lots of ice.
All right. So that gives some sense of kind of gameplay and sort of the interaction possibilities in in facade. So I just want to very briefly, each of these subsystems, we could do like a whole, hour or more long talk on. So I just want to very briefly give a sense of some of the things going on under the hood. Of course, Grace and Trip are behavior-based agents, and I'll have a little more information on the research language and stuff we're using for that. There's a drama manager, which is dynamically sequencing dramatic beats. So we're taking the idea of a dramatic beat from the screenwriting literature and playwriting literature. A dramatic beat is sort of a small unit of dramatic action that causes a value change. And values are things like the love between two characters, tension, dislike, and so forth. And so the system is dynamically sort of selecting the next beat to occur, and beats cover about 30 seconds to a minute of screen time. So sort of every 30 seconds to a minute, there's a new beat being selected, which is giving high-level dramatic goals to the characters to try to carry out during that next 30 to 60 seconds. And of course, we don't want there to be seams. So ideally, if we're doing our job right, you don't notice that the drama manager is basically reparameterizing the character simulation every 30 to 60 seconds to kind of guide the dramatic progression. And it's deciding what to pick next as a function of the entire history of interaction, including what the player said. So we're doing sort of we have an episodic memory where we're keeping track of everything that's happened and basically looking for patterns in there, as well as the desired tension arc that we're trying to track. And then natural language processing is broken up into kind of an island parser that's going from surface text directly to discourse acts. So we're trying to do minimum syntax, no semantics, and go directly to pragmatics. So everything you're typing is being recognized as discourse acts, like a flirt directed at Grace, or an oppose directed at Trip, or a reference to the couch, and so on. And there's about 25 of those discourse acts that the system knows about, and many of them take a bunch of parameters. So there's, I don't know, on the order of several hundred kind of discrete game verbs, in a sense, that the system can hear, and then all the possible text you could type is being mapped down into one or more of those, because oftentimes a single utterance will produce multiple discourse acts, and then it's up to the dialogue manager to then figure out, given the current conversational topics that are open, at where we are in the story and so forth, what's the most salient response we could have given the one or more discourse acts we've seen. Within the autonomous characters, they're built in a custom reactive planning language called ABLE, just stands for A Behavior Language. I think the most I want to say about ABLE right now is that it sort of supports parallel behavior as a language primitive, and it also supports coordinated behavior between teams of agents, side by side living with strongly autonomous individual behavior. And so Grace and Trip can, during the performance of a single line of dialogue, be doing a bunch of sort of detailed performance syncing on things like facial reactions and an eyebrow rolled at the right time when Trip says what he says and so forth, while at the same time they're pursuing fully autonomous goals. And then there's a kind of behavior library, which is a sort of declarative library of all of the different competencies that an agent has. It knows how to walk across a room. It knows how to make a drink behind the bar, and there might be a bunch of subtasks. So ABLE is, in some sense, kind of a super generalization of the behavior tree approach that's used in some forms of game AI, but kind of rolled into a first-class language with its own compiler that also supports joint intentionality. This is sort of a cartoon picture of the innards of an ABLE agent. In a typical snapshot within Facade, there's actually like dozens of parallel goals. The characters might be pulling 200 plus decision cycles a second, updating their active behavior tree 200 times a second as behaviors and individual steps are succeeding and failing, hundreds of working memory elements that are modulating behavior and so on. So it's that sort of a complex agent looks, has a lot more going on than this kind of cartoon diagram would indicate. But kind of to segue into the next project I want to talk about, one of the, on the design level, one of our inspirations for beats and for the kind of interaction that occurs within beats is drawn from looking at transactional psychology. And this is particularly Games People Play, which was a, sort of a pop transactional psych book from the 70s, which basically lists out a bunch of head games that people play with each other in dysfunctional relationships. So there's, you know, head games like Wooden Leg, and Now I've Got You, You Son of a Bitch. And, you know, it's funny. It's actually very amusing reading, I think, to sort of read through this and just, like, this catalog of dozens of these, like, head games that people play with each other. And transactional therapists would use those, you know, in therapy to kind of say, oh, you know, in this, you know, in your marriage, you're particularly doing this pattern over and over. Do you notice that? And, you know, to help people become aware of it and so on. We sort of took it the other way and kind of read this and said, God, maybe we could implement this, right? Like these, like having the characters play head games with each other that force the player, you know, basically play a head game that forces the player to interact and make a decision and participate seemed like a really powerful way to guide the interaction. And so we kind of generalized that idea of these head games to what we call social games, not the same as like a Facebook game. So what we mean by a social game or sort of, you know, a multi-participant interaction that's that involves kind of a manipulation of the social state in some way. And facade social games, there was really the affinity game, which is a game in which the player is forced to take sides in a character disagreement. And a number of beats have this pattern where they'll, you know, the decorating will be brought up, and Grace will state a position, Trip will state an opposing position. They'll reveal backstory while they state their positions. Then they'll force the player to take a side, and it's kind of zero sum. If you sort of side with Grace, Grace feels higher affinity for you, Trip feels lower affinity for you, right? And so that affinity becomes one of the major kind of steering wheels of the experience in the early part of the experience. There's also something called the hot button game, in which the player can sort of push character hot buttons on topics like sex, marriage, children, therapy, divorce. You know, there's a couple dozen of these, and, you know, kind of obvious given the domain. And as you sort of push down on one of those topics more and more, the characters become, it'll be one character in particular will become more and more uncomfortable until there'll be a big explosion. And that explosion can be a way to both accelerate the tension arc and actually accelerate the crisis. So this is kind of a major control someone can have over the whole plot arc. It also reveals more depth on that particular subtopic, more backstory, and also in the explosion, one of them will stomp out of the room, giving you an opportunity for a one-on-one. And so you can have, and those one-on-one interactions where you're not being forced into a head game and you just have a few, you know, a minute or two to just interact with a single character and try to find out more, this is one of the ways to get to that. A therapy game, players can increase characters' understanding of their problems, and then tension, which isn't really a game, but dramatic tension does increase over time and is one of the long-term progressions that the drama manager is managing. Now, the problem with these social games in Facade is that they're not explicitly modeled. Like, we as the designers knew what the affinity game was, but then when we created able behaviors for a particular beat that was an instance of the affinity game, we were the ones with our human designer intelligence and, you know, looking at the story bible we'd written and so forth that would figure out, okay, here's how we're going to instance the affinity game for a specific argument about the decorating, revealing Grace's very desire to be an artist that reveals this specific backstory topic. And so, you know, it's not like this. The AI knew about affinity game as a first-class object that it could sort of figure out how to instantiate itself. And this limited the generativity of the approach. I mean, Facade is still far more generative than sort of a scripted, you know, script and trigger system, but we wanted to go even further. And that's moved on to one of the lines of work in ICE, which is looking at explicitly modeling social games, where we're sort of taking kind of a dash of transactional psych, a dash of Goffman and symbolic interactionism generally from the social sciences literature, but specifically looking at Goffman's dramaturgical analysis of social interaction in everyday life, combining that with analysis of media like Sex and the City to produce explicit models of social games. So what we're doing is, let me define a social game. So a social game is a pattern of multi-agent interactions whose function is to modify the social state existing within and across participants. So you can think of them as like, you know, if I try to initiate a social game with two other people in the room, sort of implicitly, I might be trying to do one-upmanship. And I'm trying to show that, oh, you know, my research is better than your research or something in this little bit of one-upmanship game. Or I might be trying to save face because something embarrassing just happened. And so I'm so that the goal is a face-saving move, which is another form of social state I'm trying to manipulate. And so the social game view of the world is that we're constantly and actively performing our own identities by sort of roping in other people to play roles in these social games. And so we want to model that explicitly for non-player characters. These social games allow agents to reason and perform these social interactions to specifically manipulate social state, and this includes social norm following. So where are we finding these social games? This is where the analyzing media comes in. You know, one thing we could do is kind of naturalistic analysis where we could sit for hours or years doing really detailed ethnographies of people in bus stations and people on street corners and so on. But we want to sort of jump right to the juggler of creating, of having sort of libraries of social games that are kind of richly compelling. And where the sort of volume on them is turned way up, right? Because we're not trying to sort of model naturalistic interaction, we're trying to create media experiences and to create these playable models that support media experiences. And our assumption here is that writers for things like Sex and the City or Mean Girls, which are two that we have looked at a lot, implicitly know these social games. They kind of, these writers implicitly have a really good folk understanding of them. And when they're writing these scripts, they're kind of like turning the volume knob up to 11 on them, right? Which means that then when we sit and watch them, we actually sit there and, Josh McCoy, one of my PhD students who's been working a lot on the social games work, like held an ethnography party for Mean Girls, where he had like 20 people to get together and watch Mean Girls, where you hit the pause button like every like 30 seconds to a minute and take all the little notes. No, you know, did you notice that pattern here? And, oh, we could group that pattern as a subtype of this pattern. And pretty soon you start pulling out all these interesting multi-character social game patterns that are implicit in the script. So we're realizing these in an AI architecture called Comilfo. And in Comilfo, that there's sort of, you know, three major phases for modeling social games. There's intent formation, where a particular character, given all the games it knows about, so in this case it's like ask out, verbally abuse, rough up, physical flirt, brag. So there might be like several dozen of these, and a character has to say, well, given all the other characters in the world in the current social state, which of these do I want to play using which other characters as performers in the game, right? So that's the intent formation portion. And so you have to sort of, well, how do you decide that? And what are the, you know, how do you represent that sort of formation of volition? Once a character has sort of, you know, determined a volition to play a social game and is sort of, in a sense, roped in a responder to play it with them, how does the social game actually get performed, right? And this is where we're trying to kind of move beyond facade in terms of the human author having to predetermine exactly what appears in the performance of the social game. We'd like the performances to be determined more dynamically. And so in this case, the initiator starts a game, but the responder still has free will to accept or reject that game. So I might try to do, say, a physical flirt with someone, and if the responder is not predisposed, given the current social state, to sort of go along with it, it could backfire horribly, right? And I actually could end up, you know, having social effects like being embarrassed, having friendship go down, you know, between me and that other character, and so on. So just because an initiator decides to try and play a social game doesn't mean the responder, like, you know, robotically has to participate. Then once accept reject has been determined, there's a bunch of different outcomes that could happen. So, you know, different ways of, in a sense, kind of high level outlines for how to perform the accept or reject. And there's a bunch of these different sort of performance outlines. Then the performance outline has to actually get filled in with kind of detailed information and dialogue to say, and finally it changes the social state. And then that has sort of the performance realization results in a fallout in the world where that might change the state between like the two of us, but there might be more complex rippling effects across, you know, other, like, you know, maybe a friend of the person who I just really dissed in a social game now has become an enemy of mine, right? And that status effect actually changes. And so there's also social games have this messy propensity to have these sort of rippling out effects in the social space. That Commonwealth for Architecture has been under development for about 2.5 years through a couple of revisions. We're currently trying to sort of cash out the design of that architecture in an experimental game called Prom Week that we're, you know, knock on wood, releasing in early to mid-June. So Prom Week is a sort of social puzzle game involving a group of kind of high school alternative characters, meaning kind of goths and emos, basically. So a bunch of, in an earlier version of the game, it was kind of like the goths versus the emos battling for control of the alt prom, right? That was, but that kind of got toned down a bit. So now the goth and emos still stay in there a little bit. So goths and emos and nerds, I guess, and it basically involves the kind of high school hallway politics organized as these social games. Characters are playing with each other on the week leading up to the prom. Let me just fire up a demo. See if I've still got something. Let's see. Okay. So as I briefly mentioned, this is organized as a social puzzle game, which is not the only thing you could do with Commonwealth. This is basically like one game design that's trying to actually cash out an interesting experience based on this enabling technology. And so what I mean by a social puzzle is it's sort of organized into levels where each level, there's a specific social objective the player's trying to achieve using kind of a god game sim-like interaction. So in this case, Zach wants that, you know, he wants to become prom king. If he wants that crown, he better make sure that Naomi thinks he's cool. So social puzzle number one, Naomi needs to think that Zach is cool. And so this is Naomi, and she's sympathetic, jealous, self-destructive, and brainy. And this is Zach, and he's arrogant, stubborn, outgoing, and honest, and has the current a temporary status effect of wanting to pick on Lil currently. Lil is not in this scene. And this is how they currently feel about each other. Naomi feels a fair amount of friendship towards Zach. He feels middling friendship. There's not much romance. The red arrow is the degree of romance they feel towards each other. And Naomi, oddly enough, actually thinks Zach is somewhat cool already, but sort of not cool enough, right? So when I say that this is a puzzle game, one of the analogies we like to make is to physics puzzles. So if you look at a game like Angry Birds, for example, it's not the case that the solution to a particular level was like pre-scripted with, you know, fire three explosive birds in exactly this way, and if they hit this point, that unlocks it, right? There's actually sort of emergent solutions that come out of an underlying physics model. And the physics simulation is giving rise to a big state space, and it's up to the player to kind of surf through that state space finding a solution. Well, similarly, we're trying to use Commonwealth in Prom Week to kind of enable social physics. That in the same way, there's kind of a complicated underlying simulation of evolving social state. You've got these sort of social moves or social games that you can play, but they don't... But it's not the case that you can just deterministically do like three actions that unlocks the puzzle, like an old school adventure game. You actually have to find your sort of emergent path through. And so maybe in this case, if I sort of poke around at the social state a little more, I see that Naomi and Cassie are friends. And so maybe one thing I want to try to do is to, and I could, you know, again, I'm playing this from a kind of god game perspective, so I could either have Zach play games, social games with Cassie, or have Cassie be an initiator, right, and see what maybe doing it from that direction would be good. So let's see, I'm going to have Cassie ask Zach on a date. to see if I can spur some romance between them. And if I can get some romance going between them, because Cassie's friends with Naomi, then maybe Naomi's going to be more receptive to me doing things that make her think I'm cool because a friend of hers is dating me. See, like this, this is the kind of gameplay reasoning that we want to enable in prom week. So let's try, let's see what happens when Cassie asks Zach on a date. Zach, I was thinking, we have so much in common, okay? I mean, you like wolf spiders. Oh, it's pulling out the wolf spiders again. So it's where is this wolf spiders thing coming from? This is coming from a cultural knowledge base I'll talk about in a moment, but basically a declarative knowledge base of what people think are cool and not cool in the school. And in this case, wolf spiders is an example of something most people think is not cool, but these two characters think is cool. And that's kind of in the zeitgeist. So now they can bond over something that everyone else does not think is cool. Are you sort of following that? And so this would be an example where, like, picking exactly wolf spiders is the thing to talk about. That's during performance realization. It's the systems figuring that out. And the sort of high-level outline for this particular instantiation of the social game basically said, find something to bond over. Right? And finding something to bond over, well, one thing you can bond over is something you share that everybody else thinks is not hip. So here we go. So, do you want to go out? Well, I am really into wolf spiders. Little bit of just natural language generation hiccup there. Sounds great. Okay, awesome. So I think we just achieved a new social state change. This is debug information. We're trying to think of ways to actually present this to the player, not as just a horrible list. But right now, we just use this to try to figure out as the system does things, as we're tuning, like, why the heck was that decision made, right? And so we're one of the ways we're looking at revealing this to the player is actually to generate a narrative voiceover, or it might be a narrative text over, kind of like the narrator in Wonder Years or something, who's kind of narrating over the action and using that narration to reveal some of this information to help the players be able to form this kind of internal model of what's going on in the system. All right, so I think there we go. All right, they like each other, or they are going out now. So let's try bragging. Hey, Naomi, have you been by my locker? It's in a totally primo location, right by the cafeteria. I have it decorated with all this stuff from... Wow, this is really boring. I have to go. Oops, okay. Minus 10. Okay, that was not the social game to play with her. Okay, bye. Zach bored Naomi talking about lockers. What changed? And then we have the sort of, you know, its assessment of why it made the decisions it made. And then this is sort of counting down the number of sort of social game moves you have available to complete this particular puzzle. We do allow you to move on to the next one, even if you don't complete. But it'll make things harder as the experience proceeds. Yeah.
Actually see those statistics, or is that just for
the... I think we're going to try to reveal that same kind of information through a narrative voiceover. I think the player needs to somehow get some of that information, but probably showing it as a bunch of statistics is a little might be a little too heavy-handed and too, you know, kind of like a dating sim or something. Which is which given the sort of narrow demographic that plays dating sims, I'm gonna gather that maybe the way that they reveal information isn't the best way to do it. And they tend to be, you know, a lot of dating sims feel like spreadsheet games in which you get like way too much information kind of shoveled at you. All right, so I'm just gonna kind of briefly talk about some of the underlying AI technology in Comilfo. So underlying this, we do have this notion of social networks, which are, in our case, representing the sort of the friendship between two characters, the romance level between two characters, and the cool between two characters, right? And this is, this is different from character to character. So in other words, one character, A can think B is really cool, while B doesn't think much of A. right? So that, and we have this, these three between, existing between all the characters in the social network, within the between the NPCs. And you could choose things other than friendship, romance, and cool. That's, those are the ones we're using because it's prom week, and this is appropriate for a high school. But if you were doing, if you were wanting to use this kind of social simulation technology for a different domain, you would use different social networks. Social status. These are sort of higher level social statuses that build on the primitive networks. And we have inference rules that chain from social networks to potential social statuses, right? So we might say, oh, we're going to say two characters are dating if the romance between two characters is greater than a certain, if the mutual romance felt between two characters is greater than these values. Now, this means potentially dating. What this is actually going to do is end up adding volition to the desire to play an ask-out game. Right, and so because you still have to actually socially perform the ritual of asking out to actually make dating happen in the social sphere. It's not just, but this is what would happen there. Similarly, like more complicated rules might say things like two characters are going to be seen as potentially fighting if they currently are enemies, and this already is like a higher level social state. It's going to be inferred from lower level things, and in the past there was a third character who did a negative act to X. And Z is friends, and Y is friends with Z. So what this is saying is like two characters are already enemies, and let's see, X and Y, this gets complicated. X and Y are enemies. X did something nasty to Z, and Y likes Z. So now I'm going to be fighting with you for having done something nasty to someone I like. So this is the kind of reasoning, and we have on the order, I mean, between the sort of, we have sort of both micro theories for different social domains, like friendship and rules that just relate to friendship, as well as rules that are specific to social games, and we're sort of on the order of about 2,000 of these kind of rules in the current version of Comilfo. So that would sort of represent our social common sense knowledge for things like these transitive relationships, transitive relationship rules. The cultural knowledge base, as I mentioned, is a declarative knowledge base that sort of says what's, you know, cool or not within the entire zeitgeist of the high school, as well as individual relationships, right? So Lily has the hobby of fire tossing, but in the zeitgeist of the school, fire tossing is lame. Now, this is a bad high school. Fire tossing's cool, so... we've talked about the social game flow. There's other sorts of reasoning that is done to determine whether to accept or reject a rule. We have reasoning like, you know, for all the friends F of B, where B is someone who's being asked to respond to a social game, if the average romance of all of these friends towards the initiator is greater than neutral, that lends weight to accepting the game. And this should be read as not, you know, deterministically accept, but more like lends weight to accepting. And there's a bunch of reasoning of that form that takes place to decide whether to accept or reject a game if you're the responder. Additional reasoning determines which kind of outcome to pursue, which is then going to get filled in by performance realization and finally result in status changes. The social facts database keeps track of every social interaction that's happened so far. And this episodic memory of social interactions is actually used by the rules to both weight social games happening and during performance realization. So if you did something, let's say you cheated on a character because you were dating one character and then you started dating another and then you got the status of cheating, you might try to do something to be considered cooler to some third character, and that third character might reject and say something like, God, why would I ever trust you? You cheated on so-and-so. And it's that you cheated on so-and-so actually comes out of this social facts database. So in some sense, the player, as they play, is constantly growing their own backstory. And that backstory can be referred to computationally during performance realization of any future game.
Is there an explicit model of characters learning and forgetting both facts from that database and from the static database of who likes what, who has what, et cetera? Or is it that the whole world knows everything?
Right now, the whole world knows everything. So we have, and this is a bit of, because you're right, for some social domains, you would want to model that there is some kind of social, information propagation that happens, and it's lossy and so on. We're doing this bit of design jiu-jitsu. It's a high school. Everybody knows everything. Because it's sort of like, it's tweeted immediately, right? That's kind of a simplifying assumption we're making right now. I mean, we do have a running window on the social facts database, so we don't refer to something that's like really old, because like the player might have forgotten it, and then it'll just be like, what? And seem really random. So other than this kind of, that's a pretty simple model. So other than this kind of, running window model on the social facts database, that's all we're doing right now. I want to end by sort of just talking briefly about some other domains of work going on, both within the Expressive Intelligence Studio and across the Center for Games and Playable Media. So besides work in computational narrative, we're doing a lot of work on procedural content generation, including work on level generation, and here Tanagra, which is work by one of Jim's students, Jillian Smith, is doing mixed initiative level generation to support designers. So we're interested in like what happens when you use procedural content generation at design time to build smart design tools for game designers. Architects have CAD tools. Game designers have nothing like CAD, right? What if they did? So that's something we're thinking a lot about at Santa Cruz. And, there's a bunch of research questions that come out, and how do you build content models for different content domains? You have to start modeling perception, player perception, things like difficulty and progression, so that you can sort of score things that you generate. How do you model those perceptions? You need to support designer control and so forth. We're doing also a lot of work on formal modeling and data mining. So this includes work like reasoning about game mechanics, where we're formally representing game mechanics. We're actually using a variant of logic programming called answer set programming, and we've built kind of a custom language on top of answer set programming that specifically is amenable for representing game rules. And then we can do things like throw model finding technologies at it to allow to say things, you can build sort of a simple formal model of a game, and then say like, is it possible for the player to overcome this challenge in less than 10 moves? And it'll say no or yes and show you a witness, right? Or show me an example of the player gaining more than 5,000 resource in 3 minutes. Or, and so you can, and the idea is to support game experimentation at the sort of paper prototyping level of resolution. But these are paper prototypes that you can actually ask questions of, and they talk back, right? So that's the idea behind the sort of formal game mechanics. We're doing things like formal rule set generation. Variations Forever can generate sort of thousands of variants of this kind of abstract, it's kind of an abstract game where you're trying to, touch squares of a certain color and avoid squares of another color, and maybe you need to push them into the walls and that, and the rules are actually dynamically generated. So we're interested in like what happens when you turn procedural content generation on the rules themselves. And then that builds on the sort of formal modeling of game mechanics. We're also doing a lot of work on data mining in the context of play traces. So Icebot, it's a little dark here, but this is Icebot, our StarCraft player. It's a StarCraft playing AI where we're learning things like build order strategies by data mining the gameplay traces of Korean pro gamers. So we've actually sort of pulled off gameplay traces from about 5,000 Korean pro games, kind of munge them into a format that we can do data mining on, and we're starting to pull out patterns about different kinds of build orders, different kinds of counters, different kinds of tactics, and then use that to build an AI that can play a complex game like StarCraft at human levels of competence. But we're also using some of that same kind of data mining and analytics mojo to do things like look at gameplay traces for games. We did a project with EA where we were looking at Madden gameplay traces for online Madden play, and able to do a bunch of data analytics on that. And then a number of other areas, serious games, authoring support for non-programmers, helping them author games. So we're actually doing something with the Kodu team here, where we're modifying Kodu to basically add simple AI support for Kodu for things like learning, so characters can learn to dislike or like another character, but the trick is to still make it as accessible, as readily accessible and visual in the little visual language. You can't throw some, you know, crazy complicated thing at it, but the goal is to support more kind of storytelling style authoring in Kodu. The computational media group at Santa Cruz, so I'm one of five faculty that are in the core group. And then Noah Wardruffruin co-directs ICE with me. Lynn Walker directs the Dialogue and Natural Language Group. Jim Whitehead, who's in the front here, his interest area is software engineering and games, and he directs the Augmented Design Lab. And Arnav Jala directs the Computational Cinematography Group. And then across this group, we have sort of over 20 PhD students doing CS PhDs in technical and design games research. And a bunch of master students. And this group is sort of the core faculty for the Center for Games and Playable Media. So the Center for Games and Playable Media, our associate director here, Jane Pinkard, is in the front. The goal of the Center for Games and Playable Media is to sort of package up games research across Santa Cruz, including this core computational media faculty, but there's another five or six faculty across the campus who are doing core work, and to kind of build bridges to industry, kind of focus research, promote experiments in design, and really to serve as like a single touch point for kind of all things games research related at UC Santa Cruz. And I'll sort of end with our undergraduate computer game design degree in the computer science department. The only reason I mention them in the context of a research talk is that we do have one of the larger technically focused game programs around. We have over 400 majors in the degree now, and we're the first University of California campus to have a game-oriented bachelor's degree, and many of these students participate in our research. So within ICE alone, in any one quarter, we generally have 30 to 40 students doing independent studies, working with PhD students on the research. With that, I'll end.
Time for questions.
Yeah. I remember going to a talk 10 years ago by David Braben, who wrote Elite, and he had pretty much the same title as you. He had a lot less content on the social interactions, more content on computer-aided generation of story plots, by which we'd think missions in RPGs.
Right.
Something more exciting than gather 10 skulls, gather 20 skulls,
right,
30 reptiles.
Yes.
Do you have any work in that direction?
We do. We've got a number of projects doing work both in just story generation, kind of AI-based story generation for non-quest stories, but also work specifically, a couple of projects specifically in quest generation. And in fact, COMMO4 architecture, the same thing that's being used for the PROM, is being modified to form a new system called GrailGM for Game Master, which is a dynamic quest management technology for role-playing games, for quests that have more social, basically to support more social solutions to quests. So that if I'm, you know, trying to get a specific object from a specific NPC, and that's my quest, for example, instead of the sort of typical, sort of fight and barter solutions, there might be a more complex solution space that includes these social solutions as well. But it's also forcing us to change COMMO4, because like COMMO4 doesn't know anything about objects and their value, and about, you know, so we're having to sort of put a lot of RPG knowledge into COMMO4, which isn't currently there. But yeah, no, dynamic quest generation is really interesting and something we're interested in.
So maybe like 5 years ago, the big game industries, your action games and sports games, was chatting kind of a parallel transition from heavily scripted physics to heavily simulated physics. I'm not really a gamer, so I don't know whether, is there a collective overall, it seems like they basically got that right. We kind of believe in physics simulation now.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a collective retrospective on whether that actually made games more fun, or what, and does that inform what you're doing? As opposed to, my limited experience suggests, they got physics simulation right, and now I can
like kick a garbage can over after I blow up an alien, but it's not clear that the physics simulation per se made the games more fun. I'm curious whether you can learn from that and whether you sort of projecting forward when this works. How do you decide whether it made games more fun and what can you do to help it there?
You're right. So I think in many games, you know, they include Havoc to basically provide a more kind of believable world, but it's not actually part of the gameplay loop. So being able to kick the garbage can over is, you know, a designer could still claim that's a win because it's about immersion. You're sort of creating a more immersive world, but it's not part of the core gameplay loop. But for like physics-based puzzle games, the physics simulation is actually part of the core gameplay loop. And so I don't think there's been, to my knowledge, there has not been this kind of collective retrospective, and that would be an interesting point to see how do, you know, what does the industry sort of feel like it's learned in the move towards simulated physics? I think it's still an area of experimentation to actually have the physics simulation drive the core gameplay loop, and that sort of physics puzzle games like, you know, World of Goo would be another example, are places where we've seen the clear win. But in many sort of like AAA, you know, 3D world games, it's not clear we've seen the win on gameplay, and it's really become part of more, I'd call it like, it's helping with immersion, you know, but not with gameplay. There are, you know, a few examples. There's like the famous exploit, actually going back to Deus Ex, where you could, you know, there was an area you needed to get through, and there was sort of a stealth way through and kind of a shooting way through. And what players found was they could also, there were these little mines that you could sort of like stick on surfaces. And so if you stuck them on this wall and they exploded, it made a little sort of nick in the wall, you know, from the explosion model. And then the nick in the wall was the sort of like grasp model for the player character viewed that as a graspable surface once there was a nick in the wall. And so people were basically able to plant these mines to make a ladder over the wall and just climb over the wall and skirt the challenge entirely. Right? So that would be an example of something that was not intended by the designer, but it was an interesting example of emergent gameplay coming out of doing deeper simulation. I don't think, I haven't seen many examples in the context of that AAA space where that kind of simulation is really driving gameplay.
I don't know if I'm actually going to be able to phrase this right, but I'm somebody who worked a lot on storytelling, so I know quite a lot about stories, and I don't play games. Mm-hmm. And I'm actually wondering what's essential in stories and what's essential in games that put story that makes essentially a storytelling game a storytelling game.
The short answer here. So this is a contentious question. Within the, you know, this is, there have been huge debates over the years, both in industry and academia, about the relative virtues of pure gameplay versus storytelling, with extremists on both sides. You know, the extremists on the gameplay side would say that storytelling is always just this like skin that's put on top of the actual gameplay, and we might as well just get rid of the skin because it doesn't have, you know, it's storytelling sugar. And then there's people on the other side who say that, no, every experience is a story. And so my answer, what I'm personally interested in doing is making the story progression and character interaction itself part of the gameplay loop. So I'm less interested in purely scripted stories that are on top of gameplay that's kind of orthogonal to the story, though there are beautiful examples of, you know, like Batman Arkham Asylum, I think, is a great example of something where the gameplay verbs that are available actually really map and support the fiction. So you're really able to do Batman-like things well. And there's lots of like hiding in the shadows and swooping down and scaring the assailants. And if you just go at them like brute force, you will get shot and killed very quickly, as Batman would in that. So it isn't mutable storyline, but in the, you know, Prince of Persia Sands of Time would be another one where there's just like a very nice amplification going on between the fiction and the gameplay. But where I'm ultimately interested in going is having the player make decisions that are about changing the story direction itself, right, through their interaction.
If you take the minimal set idea of the story, it's basically black liquidated is one way of putting it. There's a critical change of state.
Right.
And in a game, it seems like there has something to do with winning and losing.
Not necessarily, though. Whereas games, and this might be a longer discussion we could take offline, but games, so one of the definitions of games does include that it has to have a valorized end condition, which is basically a winning and losing state, but not all games have valorized end conditions. So like The Sims doesn't have a valorized end condition. And then, you know, there was some debate when The Sims first came out, is this really a game? And now, N years later, the game industry is happy to call it a game. And so the problem with formal game definitions is it's completely a moving target. You know, things come out every year that push and break the boundaries if you try to sort of come up with the formal set theoretic definition of what is a game. And so...
more in terms of saying that a game is some kind of pleasurable activity.
Yeah, I think games, one of the things they do is they create high agency interaction, where agency is the experience of feeling, of having actions you want to take in the game world, being able to take those actions. Those actions are actually afforded. So the game world, through its feedback, is sort of communicating to you potential actions you'd want to take. The potential actions it makes you think of taking are actually available to you. And when you take those actions, you get feedback that makes sense given the action you take. Like if all three of those are operating, then you have high agency. And I think games are like the preeminent high agency interactive experience. Like there's lots of interactive experiences in the world. And I think what the gameness of games, a lot of it comes from agency. Like
So if you put that then together with a story, then basically this kind of making meaningful and interesting kinds of actions also basically change state in the story world and allow you to move from one place to another or something interesting.
Yeah, I mean, so games certainly involve a lot of, you know, games are all about state changes and making state changes in the world. But they don't necessarily have... if you looked at a trace of game state changes, you know, like if I sort of looked at, you know, in a sense, like the trace left over of a game when it's done, it doesn't necessarily have a well-formed story structure, right? And then you have to decide which story structure you're going to subscribe to. So in Facade, we explicitly subscribe to an Aristotelian story structure, just because in this culture, anyways, everyone from watching Hollywood movies has a deep internalized understanding of what an Aristotelian story structure looks like. And so we wanted to have that be our target for what a gameplay trace, a facade, looks like, because you can tell if you succeeded or not. Versus if we had done some more, say, experimental structure, we could have just declared victory by fiat, by saying, like, whatever came out, oh, well, that was our experimental story. So we purposely picked. And most games do not have a well-formed Aristotelian structure at the gameplay level, and then they have one sort of stamped on them through a lock and key system on the scripted storyline.
One thing that always makes me a little bit nervous when I see a game with a large possibility of forking the storyline is I feel like storyline changing elements or procedural narratives are a lot harder to predict than gameplay, other types of gameplay. So I'm thinking combat. So you come into combat, you see a little group of monsters. It's pretty easy for the player to mentally figure out in the head, do I have enough health and potions and energy and spells, and am I powerful enough to kill this group? And they can have a pretty good feel going in if they're going to win or lose, or they know kind of if they're at the borderline. And I feel with social interactions, it feels so much less predictable. I feel like it's really hard as a player to have a feel of like what's going to happen, and it's kind of this uncertainty. So some games, I'm thinking particularly, there's this game called The Witcher. It's a role-playing game. It's got a pretty wide forking storyline. And whenever I knew that I was going to have some social dialogue that was possibly going to, you know, change my game's arc pretty drastically, I'd make a save game so that I could go through it, and then if I didn't like the outcome, I'd revert. Because it was hard to predict.
Right.
And have you considered that? Like, I was looking at the high school thing, and I was like, I couldn't have any good prediction in my head of what the social interaction was going to come out to be like.
Well, something that's interesting there, though, comparing to, you know, like The Witcher, where, you know, games that do have branching storylines right now are like, and generally it's RPGs, because you have a lot of sort of, you know, quest progressions. There's still, you know, KOTOR would be another that has, Knights of the Old Republic has a lot of, you know, branching progression, but it's still been manually authored. And because it's been manually authored, in a sense, every choice point, just like the author can at each and every choice point kind of have like arbitrary non-linear craziness happen. Right? Like I could have, you know, if you say, you know, just precisely the wrong thing here in this dialogue tree, I've marked it so that the story just goes off in this crazy other direction. Right? And so, and you're sitting here saying like, God, I can't form a mental model of this to kind of be able, well, it's because there isn't anything to form a mental model of, right? Unless the author's very careful about how they author the kind of branching possibility space when they're manually doing it like that. It's really just sort of an idiosyncratic sea of branching choices. And that sense of there's nothing to predict makes sense, or that sense of I can't predict it makes sense because there is nothing to predict in some ways. Where in like The Prom, there is a consistent underlying system. You know, we haven't sat there as the human authors and arbitrarily tweaked, oh, if you try to ask Cassie out in exactly this situation, then this particular bit of, you know, craziness you've never seen before will happen. It's like, no, we've had to author, you know, a consistent playable model. And so you know, I guess the hope would be that going that sort of playable model or more simulationist route for branching, for I won't say branching story, nonlinear story and character interaction, because there's an underlying system, you can actually rapidly and iteratively experiment with it and get consistent results in a way that you can't sort of rapidly and iteratively experiment with and get consistent results an arbitrarily authored branching structure.
I still feel like it can get quite complex. I mean, just in the realm of real life human interactions, I feel I would say the same thing. Going a fight versus a social interaction, fights get way easier because there's so many forces going on in the social world.
So maybe these sort of social action-oriented games will become like what core gamers play in the future, and casual gamers will play the much easier fighting games because they have such simplistic state spaces. That would just turn that around.
It's about your own experience. If you played a lot of games where you're fighting, you're like, oh, I get this. I know how to do this, right? But the first time you run into a group of trolls, maybe you don't know if you're going to win the fight or not. It takes experience. Which, you know, I think a lot of core gamers have very specific experiences. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's why to you right now that social game model looks like, oh my God, it's crazy, I've never seen it. But then as you play it, maybe you'll be like, okay, I get this.
And I think that issue of genre expectation is key, because we've seen that actually with Facade when we were in the IGF in 2004, and so we were on the GDC show floor, and you know, and it's also been in a number of festivals over the years where I could watch like hundreds of people play it, and you know, pretty regularly, like a core gamer will walk up and just immediately like touch every object in the space that they can pick up. The characters are like talking to them and they're just like ignoring them. And then they'll go up and like kiss a bunch and then get thrown out, right? And then it's like, what happened, right? That's what, and it's just sort of like, well, those, I mean, that, you know, that was like getting thrown out was the right thing for coming into someone's apartment and sort of acting like a kleptomaniac, and then a sex maniac, you know, kissing the characters and that. And, you know, but I remember like in 2004 in particular, there was this one guy who walked up and just did this like amazing playthrough. I mean, he'd never seen the game. And it was like, it was just this nice sequence. Like Andrew and I had never seen it operate so smoothly. It was just like, oh, that's beautiful. Like, I wish we'd been videotaping that. And then we asked him like, oh, what's your background? Are you a gamer? And he says, no, I'm an improv actor. And it was just like he was, and he just like, you know, so in some sense, I'm okay with interactive storytelling being skillful.
Right.
Because that's part of, you know, because I think there's been this, one of the myths that interactive storytelling researchers have been saddled with over the year is this idea that no matter what the player does, we have to turn, you know, we have to spin, you know, silk purses out of sow's ears. You know, that the character, the player character can go in and just do any old crazy, you know, asinine thing, and we have to, like, magically morph that into a beautiful plot. And, you know, I'm just like, well, why? I mean, if you're not, like, interactive storytelling, it should be okay for it to be skillful. You know, I could imagine, you know, future interactive, you know, like, you know, when interactive drama really becomes a commercial genre, people might, like, rush over and say, oh, let's go play this new, you know, this new interactive drama at Bob's house, because, you know, Bob just makes the most interesting stories come out, you know, because he's, like, really good at it. And then, yeah, I don't know if any of this feels convincing to you.
No,
but
very enlightening. I think I've just been conditioned to the old game mechanics, and so this is new, but I think that's just my ineptitude with skill set.
I think along those same lines, I mean, like, you know, for me, like, one of the reasons I think I have not enjoyed games, especially adventure games, like, I remember being a kid playing, you know, D&D, where you'd have a dungeon master human, you know, who would let you have, like, real interactions, and that was cool, because, you know, weird things would happen, and the dungeon master's human intelligence would let them, you know, have the story go in quite different directions. But then I found with a lot of games, I get frustrated just because, like, I know there's something I'm supposed to do, and if I don't do that, I don't get the next place, and, you know, so what I think, what I wanted to ask, though, in that context is, like, so I think one way in which the community who likes games like that are more open-ended and have more real interaction has been the MMORPGs, where you have, you know, the massive multiplayer kinds of games, and things like Second Life, where you can actually have real interaction with humans. And so here, you know, the kind of work you're talking about brings in something where it's somewhere in between, where there's still an authored story arc, you know, but there's enough intelligence in the interaction of the characters that you get more of that openness in the play. And I'm wondering of what you think about the spectrum between, like, full-on, just set up a world and real humans go and play all the parts, versus the kind of work you're talking about, and if you think those are different spaces, or if there's kind of a continuum there.
No, it's a good question. I mean, they're definitely related. Yeah, so I'll just have sort of a couple of random answers, and then we can continue talking. So one thing about having high quality experiences in MMOs, so, like, I actually am not that much of a modern MMO player, but in the early 90s, I spent a lot of time in Lambda Mu and used to run my own Lambda Mu core and stuff like that. So I've definitely spent a lot of time in massively multiplayer spaces before. And it takes a lot of work, a lot of skillful work on the part of a large number of people to create a successful experience, right? So there's something that, like, you know, I'm not, you have to have acquired, in a sense, the social capital of having this group of friends who have all practiced together for a long time in a particular social space before you can all just get on and have something that feels really kind of emergent and engaging happen. And so, you know, one reason I'm interested in having AI support for things like that is that that's, I would like to be able to make that kind of experience more more broadly accessible than to this.
Instead of having to do a lot of work for setup to train all the individual players and, like, this is your role, and this is, like, you would in a murder mystery game where you have to
right.
train each player, this is your background, this is how you should act, you should be nice to this person, mean to this person, all this kind of stuff. Instead, you can just have that as part of the knowledge of the system, so you can walk in and
right.
be immersed instantly.
Like, in some sense, you know, with these kind of technologies, I can sort of, you know, ship that experience to, you know, 50 million people in a way that I can't ship, you know, a strongly, but I certainly look at, like, actually a community I've been looking at a lot in recent years is the Scandinavian LARP scene. And I don't know if people here have looked at Nordic LARPing at all, which is the live action role playing, but it's a far cry from people, you know, with capes and wooden swords in, you know, sub-basements, which is, you know, when we think of LARPing in the U.S., we think of, you know, the sort of, it's like kind of geeky, and you know, and the Nordic LARP scene is, these are like outrageous social experiments. I mean, they'll do things where they will, you know, they will like, you know, set up in a building for a week and live a society that has three genders. And so they will, and it's actually this kind of like really complex experiment in what would the sort of gender politics of a society with three genders look like, right? And they'll set that up, or they'll set up like, you know, here's a you know, here's a group of people, and it's like the last stand of a failing rebellion, right? And then that, and then you experience that for 24 hours or 36 hours. There's actually some really extreme versions of Nordic LARPing that have looked at, what do they call that subgenre? It's bleed LARPing, where you're really trying to erase as much as possible the boundary between the LARP and real life. And the bleed LARPs have taken on some really intense themes that I don't want to talk about on something that's apparently being shared all over the place. They've done some experiments in really extreme social behaviors in the Nordic LARP scene. And it is groups of people getting together and sort of setting up these kind of game rules that they then improvise within. And so that's sort of the most like hardcore improvisational storytelling gaming scene like anywhere on the planet.
You talked about angry birds. We've got 500 years of physics to tell us the variables are mass, inertia, coordinate, velocity, acceleration. How are you going to get the right variables for social things? Mm-hmm. In the prom, there were three variables. Were they correct?
Right. There's more. I mean, in some sense, there's more than three variables because there's lots of binary state and other forms of state besides the besides those numbers. So you're asking though, are they correct? So we don't have Newtonian. We don't have some equivalent of Newtonian physics for social interaction, or like Harry Sheldon psychophysics from Foundation series or something. But we do have. This is partly why we're borrowing our intuitions for social games from media. Because media experiences, you know, like, you know, television shows and movies and stuff, do successfully convey social interactions to us, even though they're not real social interactions, right? If you actually look at what's going on in the movie screen and the way people are talking to each other, and it's like, people don't talk to each other that way, right? And they don't have, and yet we can read it. We're not confused. And we can actually read it strongly and get a very strong social signal out of it. And so, our answer, in some sense, is to say, okay, so we, you know, the scientists haven't figured it out, in the sense of, you know, like we don't have psychophysics, but the artists have. So can we study the character arts, and from the character arts, basically build AI models of what they're doing? That's, I guess, in a nutshell, that's how we're skirting around not having Newton's laws for social interaction.
Okay. Now let's go and say last. Okay. Last question.
Mine wasn't even a question. I was just going to chase that with the Kill Shakespeare comic. Actually, feel a lot like what you just described, where they essentially take a model of the Hamlet character and lift him out of this environment, lift the Juliet character out of her environment at a particular time, drop them in, and then like, oh, how would Othello and Iago interact with one another? Well, we already have a clear understanding of that. How would Othello and Hamlet interacting with each other? We don't have as clear an understanding from the text, but if you build an interesting enough, you know, sufficient enough model of what are the mass and acceleration and velocity, you know, sort of constructs, then that kind of storytelling makes sense to be able to, you know, automate that. To be able
oh,
to
cool. So what is this comic?
It's called Kill Shakespeare.
Kill Shakespeare, okay, I don't know, that sounds, I'm definitely gonna have to check that out. Cool.
Let's thank the speaker once again.